Welcome to Lifestyle by Design, helping you solve everyday challenges. I'm Karen Jacobs, an occupational therapist, a professor at Boston University, and a Brookline Rotarian.
And I'm Andrea Calso, the Brookline Access Television Community Relations Coordinator. As always, the format of our show discusses topics of health, well-being in your body, but also in your community. And today we have a really, really exciting guest. We're visited by a Brookline organization, Hospitality Homes, and they're gonna tell us what they're about and the service that they provide not only to Brookline, but to the greater Boston area. So we're gonna share that with you. And then we also have a really great discussion with Karen, who is an occupational therapist. And I think that these two topics really tie in well in terms of, you know, how we help each other in our daily lives, in our working lives, and what resources and opportunities that we have in our community. So we'll meet with Hospitality Homes and we'll be right back.
Opportunities for kids to participate in charity. And what's nice about Hospitality Homes is the kids can really be junior hosts. That oftentimes, you know, we're busy, we have a phone call or work or something, and the kids will be the ones that greet the guests and show them around the house and make them feel comfortable. And, you know, here are the towels and here are the bathrooms and, you know, there's where the bus stop is. And the kids can really take ownership of that.
So as you can see from the clip, we've shared a little bit about one of the topics we're going to discuss today, which is Hospitality Homes. Hospitality Homes provides short-term housing to people who are visiting the Boston area to receive medical care for a family member or even a close friend. And we are joined by two representatives from Hospitality Homes, Caryl Goodman, who is the executive director, and Hindell Grossman, who is one of our hosts for the organization. So they're going to tell us a little bit more about what it's all about, what it's like to participate in Hospitality Homes. Thank you for joining me today on our show. Caryl, can you please tell me a little bit about sort of the history of Hospitality Homes, how it got started, what it's all about?
Sure. 30 years ago, a woman named Doris and her daughter Pamela traveled from California to Boston for cancer care. The care that young Pamela needed wasn't available in California, so they traveled here so that Pam could receive life-saving care. And hotels in Boston at that time even were extremely expensive and beyond what Doris could afford. So she was sleeping on the floor in the waiting room. Wow. And the nurses and the other people who were on the floor noticed what was happening and felt that that wasn't appropriate. Plus, she wasn't getting a good night's sleep. So they found an empty room in an office building next door and moved in a bed for Doris to sleep. She slept there a few nights, and then staff members began taking her home to their own homes to sleep there. And that was really the start of our program. They were the first volunteer hosts who opened their homes and their hearts to people visiting Boston for medical care.
Wow, that's incredible. You know, we mentioned you serve the Boston area, but who are your constituents, both hospitals, individuals?
We're the only hospital housing option in Boston that helps everyone, regardless of what hospital they're the patient is admitted to, regardless of their disease, their age, their background, or their income. We have over 70 families in the local area who are volunteer hosts, much like Hindell, who open their homes and welcome the guests, which is very reassuring. Many of our families travel from Maine. People from Maine are not used to busy city traffic. They're not used to public transportation. They're not used to huge medical centers that they're coming to visit in Boston. And having a home to return to each night is very reassuring, and it makes it a much more enjoyable experience in spite of the fact that they're all dealing with very serious medical issues. I can tell you one story about Niels. Niels was about 2 years old and was diagnosed with a glioma, which is a brain tumor similar to the type that Ted Kennedy had. And his parents brought him to Children's Hospital in Seattle, which is a very good academic healthcare center in Seattle. But there was nothing the doctors could do for Niels, and they didn't know of any treatments. So the parents went online and realized that there were two places in the United States that was having success treating pediatric brain tumors like Niels, one of which was here in Boston. So they decided to come to Boston for 3 months of treatment. Well, the average price of a hotel room in Boston is over $200 a night, and when you multiply that by 3 months, very few families can afford that. And if it hadn't been for the free housing that we provided, Niels and his family wouldn't have been able to come to Boston. But it makes me really happy to say that Niels is now cancer-free, and his family is totally indebted and grateful to Hospitality Homes for making that possible.
That's wonderful. So for families like those and any other, what's the process like to apply? How do most people find out about these services?
All of the Boston hospitals, rehab centers, anyone that does healthcare in Boston knows about us. Social workers often refer to us. We have an online application that's on our website, and that's available 24/7 for people to apply. They can also call our office phone, 888-595-4678, and apply over the phone. Once we get the application, we check references on every adult guest that applies for us, and then we match the incoming family with our host families. What hospital they're coming to, so we can get them to a host that's nearby, how many beds they need, can they climb steps. If they speak Spanish, we try and place them with a host that is Spanish speaking. So we do a very careful match with our hosts. And the hosts also have preferences. Some hosts prefer to host guests for 1 or 2 nights. Some hosts prefer long-term guests, 2 or 3 months. So we take all those variables and we do a match. And the other thing we do is anytime a family is coming back for a repeat visit, we try and match them with the same host if that host is available. Because the hosts and guests really do develop a relationship. Right. Some of them celebrate birthdays together, or they invite each other to weddings, or they share vacations. And we do all we can to support that relationship.
Wow, so it sounds like it's very intimate. And I'm wondering, Hindell, as a host, maybe you can speak a little bit more to that. You know, how did you first hear about this and want to get involved with Hospitality Homes?
I actually saw an ad in the newspaper. I think it was the Brookline tab, looking for volunteers, and I was looking to do something helpful to someone else.
Right.
And so this opportunity suited, you know, what I envisioned as something that I could do for 3 reasons. One is I wanted to help someone that was needy. Two is I had an extra bedroom. And three, after speaking with the hospitality homes staff, I realized how much they protect the hosts and how well-treated the hosts are. And I appreciated the fact that they were there to intervene because of the relationship that gets developed with the guests and with hospitality homes. And I felt that that was a safe thing for me to do, to allow people to come into my home that I didn't know.
Right. So it sounds like they are giving some ongoing support, training, getting feedback from both the families and yourselves.
Right.
And, you know, can you tell me a little bit about what specifically it's been like to have some families come and stay with you?
It's a really marvelous experience. I prefer the shorter term visits, that is 10 days or less. Mm-hmm. I'm primarily due to scheduling reasons in my life. I get contacted primarily or initially by hospitality homes by email, and I'm often given a list of possible guests. And I look at them. I don't have a preference for age or location from where they come or any of those things. It's really just a matter, for me, my primary issue is the duration of their stay. And then my phone number is given to the guest. The guest contacts me directly. We make an arrangement to rendezvous at my home. I give them directions, and then we meet at a certain time. They usually give me some idea of what their schedule will be like for the week with respect to medical treatment. And, you know, I make the room, the space available for them so it's comfortable, you know, put out clean sheets and towels and soaps and make sure the room is clean, and I show them in and they get them settled. They're so appreciative just from the start having a nice place to come back to. And the situation in my home is that I have a whole separate level where they stay, and so I give them a key to the door so they can come and go as they wish. Just figure I'd like to give them as much freedom and independence as possible so they don't, right. They're not forced to have a conversation with me if they don't want to. I know that they've had a trying day with medical treatment, either for themselves. Yeah. Sometimes I host a patient, or sometimes I just host a family member or two of a patient. And I want to give them the freedom to not have that conversation with me if they want to. So they can come and go as they wish. They can come home late if they wish. I have no curfew, I tell them. And it's just lovely. You know, sometimes I leave them cookies or fruit, and sometimes they leave me things.
That does sound really wonderful.
It's a really nice relationship.
And even for the short stays, it sounds like you get to really know these people and what they're going through, and just show them, you know, what is Boston like, what are the residents of Boston Brookline area like. So it sounds like it's a really good service on both sides.
And it's a very flexible way to volunteer. Hindell can do it when she's available, and there's absolutely no pressure from the office to host when she's not available. As she said, it can be long-term or short-term stays. And the relationship with between the guest and the host is totally up to them. And you don't have to have a separate level. People have a pull-out sofa. Some hosts have large homes. Some hosts have very small homes. Every host develops house rules so that they communicate quite clearly with the guests what are the expectations and what are sort of the normal routines of the home. So in no way do the guests interfere with the daily life of the hosts.
Right, because sometimes you have families, you have pets, things like that in the home, but it seems like that it can accommodate sort of any shape and size of those circumstances.
Yes, it's wonderful. I mean, for me, for example, if my son comes from college, I prefer not to have a guest in the house at that time because of the dynamic. And they're actually, I guess, the Hospitality Homes guests are using his room. So when he comes home, I obviously need to have his room available. But it makes, first of all, it makes better use of the real estate. It does something nice for someone who needs it, and it really is, you know, an accommodation for people who in Brookline, particularly because of its proximity to hospitals,
yes.
Makes a really lovely visit for people. Even though they're coming for medical treatment, they also enjoy right. coming to Brookline.
Right, and that can make such a big difference. So you mentioned you had 70 families currently participating. So what are the needs for you in terms of outreach? Are you looking for more families? What are the other sort of resources that people can do to help? Maybe they can't volunteer, but they want to get involved in some other way with the organization.
Well, first of all, to spread the word, we definitely need more hosts. Right now, the summer's a very busy time, and we're not able to host every family that reaches out to us for housing. And that situation is going to become worse because of changes in medical financing and referral patterns. With the new laws about health insurance and health reimbursement, more and more families are going to be coming to Boston for longer stays, and they're going to be sicker. So the hospitals have warned us that there is this change afoot. Mm-hmm. So we're working very hard to recruit more families so that we don't have to say no, that like we're saying this month. Mm-hmm. There are times when the city is extremely busy during graduation weekends, for example, or if one of our sports teams is in the finals, or during marathon week and during the crew race in Cambridge, there are no hotel rooms in Boston. So anyone coming to Boston for medical care needs a place to stay. And that's where we come in. We try as hard as we can to place every family that needs us, but we need more hosts in order to do that.
Great. And so I have, we'll have some of this information here, but you have a lot of information, fact sheets, pamphlets to learn about more about the organization, as well as, you know, what you can do if you want to become a host. If you're watching this and you find that this matches your need to apply, I know you have an event coming up, a golf classic, so that might be something you'd want to participate in as well. And then we'll also share the links online, so you can visit online. It's hosp.org. You can find all this information there as well, and we'll show it on the screen. So I wanted to thank you both very much for joining us.
My pleasure.
This is a wonderful Brookline resource and an opportunity for Brookline residents to get involved and give back to their community. So we really do appreciate you joining us and telling us more about it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Andrea.
Is he always that mean to you?
It's like he tracks my every move.
And he won't let me see my friends.
I've started hiding the bruises.
The violence has to stop.
Domestic violence happens in many ways to many people. But we can put it to an end. Respond can help.
So we're back with Caryl, our resident occupational therapist. And we've talked a little bit and mentioned occupational therapy on this show and tying it with the topics, but we've never specifically talked about what is occupational therapy and what do you do with occupational therapy? So
thank you.
Let's start off with the definition.
Thank you. I'm actually going to start off with a little exercise with you for a minute. Okay? So I want you to close your eyes. And I want you to think of your very favorite activity that you love to do. And you can tell me what it is, or you don't have to.
I like to read.
You like to read. Okay, now open your eyes to a new reality where, unfortunately, you're unable to do that anymore. You might have been in an accident, maybe acquired some kind of disease, anything. An occupational therapist would be there to help you be able to do that meaningful activity, maybe in a different way, but they'd be able to help you do what's really important to you. So occupational therapy is a health and rehabilitation profession. We work with people of all ages, so newborns to the very, very old people, and we help them do whatever is meaningful to them.
Right, and I know that there's specific areas of occupational therapy. Can you walk me through some of those?
Sure. Well, let me just say that wherever there's a person or a population of people, there can be an occupational therapy practitioner. So occupational therapists go to school. Now the entry is on a master's level. And then there's occupational therapy assistants, which is on a two-year level. And in the Boston area, there's quite a few schools for both people. So the first thing I want to say is that we may be in all different areas, and I'm going to talk about six areas, but there's so many opportunities. Again, wherever there is a person or population, an occupational therapist could be there. So there's six broad areas of practice that the American Occupational Therapy Association has identified to help people better understand what occupational therapy is. So one of them is working with children and youth, and that could be being in the school system, working with a child, for example, who might have an IEP, individual education plan, where it's identified that they need occupational therapy services, and that might be a child with a learning disability or a child who has autism, and the occupational therapist might be working with them in the school environment. We, in that regard, that big broad area of working with children and youth, could be working with a newborn baby who might be premature, and one of the things that we'll be doing with that child is actually more with the caregiver, helping the parents know how to work with the baby. So for me, one of the areas that I am involved in is children and youth, and another area which is work and industry. But the children and youth area, I do research with middle school children, helping better understand how they use technologies such as notebook computers and iPads, and also backpacks and carrying backpacks. So work in industry is another broad area. An occupational therapy practitioner might be in a business, actually an employee there, helping employees be able to do their jobs, maybe someone who's had an illness or an injury, or acknowledging that there are some hazards in the workplace and helping to redesign or to come up with different strategies so a person can do their job. And for me, I'm also a board certified ergonomist. So the area of ergonomics is an area that I have expertise in, and so I might enfold that into what I would do in work in industry. Productive aging. We have an aging demographics. Occupational therapy practitioners are working in skilled nursing facilities. They're helping the older person find meaningful activities that they enjoy doing. For some people who might have challenges, say low vision issues, maybe dementia, they might be working with the caregiver family members. They might be helping someone be able to dress in the morning, what we call activities of daily living, to be able to do that again, to be as independent as possible. We say that we help people live life to its fullest, and that might be one of the things we might do with the productive aging. And being an aging baby boomer, I'm always looking at strategies that an occupational therapist might do with me to be able to stay healthy.
Right.
And so exercise, making sure yes. that I don't like formal exercise, but walking.
Right.
And so the occupational therapist for an older person might work on understanding their daily activities, sort of like a time log, mm-hmm. and seeing where they may be able to integrate some of the activities like walking
right.
or socializing with people can be built into the
We've
daily
touched
activity.
On that topic,
we
I
have.
Know, and you've lectured mm-hmm. me about certain
I
things.
Have.
So I do encourage, we don't have to revisit all of it today, but
no.
I do encourage you that if you want to learn about mm-hmm. posture with your screens and computers, to see our first episode. We talked about that, and we talked about taking breaks, stretching.
Absolutely.
We've also introduced yoga into our show mm-hmm. with that stretching and exercise. And I think one thing you mentioned about the aging, I think a lot of these things we mentioned, they apply to all ages.
All ages,
And I find mm-hmm. that these are helping me as well.
Great. I've noticed that your posture is better when we're on the show.
Yes. Well, on TV.
On TV.
You have to.
That's okay. But thanks for saying that, because that actually leads into another area that's really important in occupational therapy, which is health and wellness. And when we had on our show, the show that we talked about yoga, that actually was an occupational therapy student who developed went through training to be a yoga instructor, and she's incorporated those yoga strategies into what she's doing as an occupational therapist.
Right.
But the whole health and wellness area is really important,
right.
again, across the age span. And something that's easy for us to integrate, an area that's, I think, definitely growing for occupational therapists and occupational therapy practitioners to move into, to go more into the community, to go where the people are who want to stay healthy. One area that I see is many people are what we call worried well. and so stress management strategies
yes.
might be something that we'll do again with this health and wellness
right,
broad
right.
area.
And we've talked about even, you know, as simple as nutrition and healthy mm-hmm. living recipes. So this isn't necessarily something where it's specific to one area of
mm-hmm.
life. It's a little bit of everything. That's, I think, what fascinates me about it is that, you know, your profession is almost everything.
It's very broad. We're not nutritionists. But
right.
what we do when I actually teach healthy cooking is help people learn how to cook correctly, how to integrate all of that, and work with an interprofessional team like a nutritionist or a
right.
dietitian as well. Another broad area of occupational therapy is mental health. I talked about just briefly the worried well. They might go into that category, but there's many people who have disorders that we might work with. In Brookline, we have Brookline Mental Health, which is definitely an area where an occupational therapy practitioner could work. Under that mental health area that is a growing area where occupational therapists are involved is the whole thing about anti-bullying. And that's so important. And we're seeing that occupational therapy practitioners are helping in schools trying to develop strategies to overcome that or to help people understand that there's different ways of communication.
Right.
So again, another very important broad area of practice. So as you said, an occupational therapy practitioner and occupational therapy is very broad, but each of us develops expertise in an area
right.
so that we become experts in it. So the marathon and what happened at the marathon, people might be in a broad area of rehabilitation,
mm-hmm.
working with people who were injured in the marathon bombing. And so some of these people may now have a disability. Maybe they lost a limb. An occupational therapy practitioner would be working with them to help them develop different strategies. They might help them work with a prosthesis that they now will be wearing. So again, another very broad area, but the key is we help people do what's really important to them,
right.
And we help them be able to live life to its fullest.
That's great. And I know that you are a professor at Boston University.
Right.
So you work with students, people who are looking into starting out in this field. Mm-hmm. So I want to talk a little bit about that, because I think that it's really good information now when you're thinking about a career or even perhaps switching at the master's level, finding your specialty, finding your focus. Who is a good candidate for this job? Are there certain personalities or skills that make one well suited?
That's a great question. I first want to start with that occupational therapy has been listed at number 7 out of the top 10 professions. So we have lots of people changing their careers to come into occupational therapy because it is such a satisfying profession. So for me as a professor, the things I look for in a student and then would look for that person as an occupational therapy practitioner would be someone who's very interested in working with people and populations. Our profession is very client-centered, and so wanting to work with a person and make them the focal point is important. Someone who's very interested in understanding the evidence literature. Occupational therapy has a vast amount of literature that supports what we do. So research that supports it. We're science-driven as a profession. So someone who's very interested in learning about the science and the evidence with occupational therapy and to be able to incorporate that. And then a person who, again, is open to opportunities and to see things perhaps a little differently. I think creativity is really important. I think having good communication skills is another thing. But I think someone who really just wants to sink their teeth into a profession, that's a career of a lifetime, because there's so much flexibility in occupational therapy. So I might start out understanding and wanting to be in one of those areas that I described, and maybe I'll decide I want to have a family and then take a little bit of time off. As long as I continue with my education in that area to make sure that I'm at the state of the art of evidence, I might switch to a different area. Or what I might do is decide that I want to work part-time, and there are part-time jobs as well. So a lot of flexibility in this profession. And for me, I've been in this profession for a very long time, over 33 years. I find every day exciting, and I love getting up in the morning to go to work. And if someone wants a job that feels so good about what they're doing, that's
and it also seems with the versatility that it's not necessarily your typical desk job or your typical 9-to-5.
Right.
So you get that opportunity to move out. And I know we've sort of touched on it already, but can you give examples of kind of the places you might be working?
Sure, that's great. A majority, about 25% of occupational therapy practitioners work in schools. Other ones will be in a skilled nursing facility working with an older population. Others might be in a rehab or a hospital. Others will be in the community. And so there's vast areas, but a majority of occupational therapy practitioners are in schools in the United States. But occupational therapy is an international, global profession. And when you travel to different countries, you might see occupational therapy in different areas of practice. So for me, the other satisfying part is that I'm part of a global community, and there's power in numbers and in helping people understand what is the value of occupation, which is the meaningful everyday activities, and the power of that in helping people live their life to its fullest.
Wonderful. Well, I think that this has been very informative for me.
That's
and
great.
I know that you have a blog, so I would encourage anyone that wants to find out more about this field, and about your work to visit that. You know, we've talked about some of these topics before. Next month we're going to be talking about the backpack project you did. So there's some really great information there. So thank you for joining us today on Lifestyle by Design. To view more of our episodes, you can find them online at batv.org. You can also find them on YouTube at youtube.com/BrooklineAccessBATV. And you can watch us on Comcast and RCN Channel 3, Brookline Access Television, Tuesdays 10 a.m. and 8 p.m. and Saturdays at 8 p.m. Thanks for joining us.